Remember, December 7th, 1941.
Yeah. welcome Deborah Burdick, Campus Ladies of Bill Green State, Second Vice President.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I am so very honored to be here to represent our Campus and Campus Ladies Auxiliary Department of Wisconsin. We are here to remember a Pearl Harbor attack on December 7, 1941, to honor any survivors still with us. Do we have any survivors here today? If so, thank you for your service. It would turn out to be one of the worst military defeats of American history, killing 2,403 sailors, soldiers, and civilians. The Japanese damaged and destroyed 19 Navy ships, including 8 battleships and more than 300 aircraft. One of our post-war members, the now deceased Navy veteran Chuck Lewinsky, on December 7, 1941, was in Little Pearl Harbor when the attack happened. He pulled out bodies out of the harbor that day. He told us a lot of stories of what he had to do. It was very heartbreaking. He had 3 sons that joined the Navy to follow their dad's footsteps. God bless our veterans, past, present, and future, and God bless America. From our Amleth family to yours, Merry Christmas and happy in the morning. Less than a half an hour later,
A bomb was dropped in the kitchen where he had been working, killing all that were present. Hearing the commotion, my dad and a buddy decided to make it to the airfield to see if they could arm any planes. A pilot asked them to help get planes in the air. They ran across the runway, my dad's buddy a few feet behind him. A Japanese plane strafed the runway, killing my dad's buddy, who was only about 6 feet behind him. A second close call. The third came in a few minutes. My dad pulled the shocks from the wheels of a fighter to help get it airborne. A couple Japanese planes strafed the lineup of airplanes along the runway, disabling all the planes and starting the one plane that they had started the taxi to the runway, started it on fire. No planes got airborne from Hickam Field. The attack lasted 90 minutes, and all 138 planes were destroyed on Hickam Field. Uh, 189 servicemen were killed, another 303 wounded. Six planes did get airborne, two from Hialeah and four from Wheeler, and two of the pilots shot down six airplanes of the Japanese. We lost 2,335 service personnel, another 1,143 were wounded. The Japanese lost 129 servicemen. My dad, after helping clean up Hickam Field, spent time in Guadalcanal, Panama, and later in the Philippines. He passed on in 2010 at the ripe old age of 93, and that's his story.
Department
to the Navy 1 month before the U.S. entered the war in November 1941. Coast Guard units in Hawaii have been serving alongside the Navy since that summer and fully integrated with their Navy counterparts by the time the attack had occurred. The service participated in pre-war neutrality patrols guarding against attacks by the belligerent warships in the Atlantic. And since June of 1941, the Coast Guard had overseen the Greenland Bear of operations in sea, land, and ice operations. And there, they had seized the U.S.'s first enemy vessel of World War II. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt labeled December 7, 1941, as a date that will live in infamy. In his war declaration speech, in the battle, the Coast Guard units served alongside the Navy, firing anti-aircraft barrages against the Japanese attackers and performing high anti-submarine patrols. Coast Guard cutters, patrol boats, bases, stations, lighthouse, and personnel assigned to the 14th Naval District supported U.S. naval forces that day. Early that day, on December 7th, while on a regular patrol, the Coast Guard cutter Tiger intercepted a dispatch from the Navy destroyer, the Ward, that claimed the destruction of an enemy submarine. Later, the Tiger detected an underwater object on her sonar near Barbara's Point. Believing this might also be a submarine, the Tiger maneuvered to get a better position and stopped both engines to reduce their sonar interference. Hearing motor noises, the Tiger continued trailing the sound towards the harbor entrance. The small cutter tracked the object toward the left side of the channel, but abandoned the search when it ran into shoal water. The Tiger continued her patrol toward Pearl Harbor entrance. Passing the open harbor, the anti-submarine net before 8 o'clock. At around 8 a.m., to the surprise of the men on board, the cutter came under fire. The fire came from an undetermined source and fell within 100 yards. The Tiger's commanding officer called the crew to general quarters and observed the Japanese planes heading south away from Pearl Harbor and immediately headed for her designated wartime station off the entrance of Honolulu Harbor. After the two waves of the Japanese planes withdrew from Pearl Harbor, Coast Guard small craft secured port areas. They blacked out all of their navigational aids, their station guards along the waterfront. The Coast Guard cutter Tiger maintained a patrol off the harbor entrance during the night. In the darkness, overlaying anxious army units along the shore, firing on the cutter. When the Japanese began their attack, the Coast Guard cutter Taney lay moored at Pier 6 in Honolulu Harbor, 6 miles away from the naval anchorage. At first, the Japanese craft appeared over the island. Taney's crew went to general quarters and made preparations get underway. The Taney fired on formations of enemy aircraft with her 3-inch guns and 50 caliber machine guns. One patrol boat designated as CG-8 was at general quarters and getting the ship underway to move to Sand Island to pick up the depot keeper while the bombs exploded nearby. It then proceeded back across the channel to Kwali Base aircraft while en route. At the basin, CG-8 prohibited the small private vessels and sampans from leaving until the naval intelligence could clear the owners. The buoy tender Walnut unexpectedly became involved in one of the FAR actions of the attack. The Japanese sent a force of destroyers to Midway Island to neutralize any American naval forces there. About 1,000 miles northwest of Hawaii, these destroyers shelled Midway Island. The Walnut station there observed gun flashes from the northwest. Shells began landing within 100 feet of her, but the Walnut remained anchored during the 30-minute attack. Unharmed, the tender later steamed to Hawaii and received guns and depth charges to safely perform the aids to navigation duty during the war. Other units participating that day included the patrol cutter of the Alliance, the buoy tender Kukui, several patrol boats, a buoy boat, and a former lighthouse service launch, Lahua. Coast Guard radiomen manned the communication station at Diamond Head Lighthouse, broadcasting that the attack was underway. Coast Guard aviator Lieutenant Frank Erickson later pioneered that the helicopter flight was at Ford Island before the attack, and he took command of an anti-aircraft battery fighting off the enemy aircraft. What's important about Lieutenant Erickson, so back in 1941, the Coast Guard didn't have any helicopters to perform their search and rescue missions. Lieutenant Erickson came up, thought of the idea of how could we hoist people out of the water. He remembered seeing all of the individuals fighting for their life in the water, and there's nothing we could do. Lieutenant Erickson eventually went to Sikorsky over in New York, and he and Sikorsky actually developed the hoist and the hoist procedures for that. So on December 7th, the Coast Guard proved worthy of the service's motto, Semper Paratus, always ready. But that day was only the start of what could become part of our time, our legacy, and to include many more losses. In early 1942, the Coast Guard cutter Alexander Hamilton became the service's first battle casualty. Later, the Coast Guard manned and transported the USS Wakefield. They delivered Allied troops to Singapore. They evacuated many island civilians, population, and suffered its own casualties from Japanese bombers. The Coast Guard cutter Arrakis sank the second U-boat destroyed by U.S. forces and captured the first German prisoners of war. In August of 1942, the U.S. military launched its first land defense of World War II at Guadalcanal. The struggle for this island proved the first true test of all branches of the American military, including the Coast Guard, against battle-hardened Japanese forces within the enemy-held territory. It became one of the most honored combat operations in the Coast Guard history, with service members receiving the Purple Heart, the Bronze Star, the Silver Star, and Navy Cross medals, the Presidential Unit Commendation, and the Coast Guard's only Medal of Honor recipient, Signalman First Class Douglas Monroe, who perished putting himself in harm's way to extract then Lieutenant Colonel Chesty Puller, Chesty Puller's three companies of Marines off Uganda Point. Pearl Harbor had proven a lopsided victory for the Imperial Japanese. However, by the end of 1942, the tide of the Pacific War had turned the favor of the U.S. and our Allied forces. For the next 2.5 years, the Allies would fight island battles whose names were written in blood against retreating Japanese forces. The Coast Guard participated in all of these major amphibious operations, including Saipan, Guam, Iwo Jima, and Okinawa. Coast Guardsmen also operated thousands of Coast Guard Army and Navy supply ships that supported the U.S. troops and Allied fleets in the Pacific. Thank you for continuing to remember the events that took place on December 7th, 1941, as we pay tribute to those who fought and honor the people who gave what Abraham Lincoln called their last full measure of devotion, defending our nation. God bless the United States.
When men will have the security and confidence, it is written in the book of the prophet Isaiah, nation shall not pick up a sword against another nation, Then the glory of God shall be revealed and will be seeked out together. Amen.
Amen. Welcome once again to the University of ROTC, assuming God bless you. You're welcome to you all. Thank you for attending the program.